Now let's talk about the medications that you'll be on after transplant. There are two main groups of medications to review. The first are called the immunosuppressants, which are taken to help prevent rejection. There are three of these drugs that are usually lifelong. These three drugs work by lowering or suppressing your immune system, and because of this, you'll be at a higher risk for certain infections. The next class of medications, the anti-infectives, prevent these infections. These two infection prevention drugs will be temporary. This slide is an overview of the immunosuppressant or anti-rejection medications that you'll be on. Before we continue, I want to mention that all medications have possible side effects. Now, some patients have no side effects, while others may have more side effects or are more sensitive to these medications. We'll be monitoring you very closely on these medications and are able to address issues if they occur. The first medication that most people will be on is a medication called Prograf or tacrolimus. This is the primary anti-rejection medication and will be taken lifelong. It'll be twice a day, and it's important to take these medications 12 hours apart. This allows the medication to stay in steady levels in the blood. We'll be adjusting these medications based off your lab work. We'll check your blood levels of this medication, and that will allow us to determine the optimal dose for you. Some of the more common side effects are listed to the side. You'll be monitoring your blood pressure at home and possibly your blood sugar. This drug can sometimes cause shaky hands or recurring headaches. If either of those occur, then let the clinic know. It could be a sign that we need to adjust your dose, and we'll be doing routine lab work to monitor your kidney function as well. The next medication is called Zortris or Everolimus. This medication is sometimes used instead of tacrolimus or mycophenolate. It is also a twice-a-day drug taken lifelong. Like tacrolimus, the dose of this medication will also be adjusted based off of your lab work. Some of the more common side effects are listed to the side. This drug can cause poor wound healing sometimes and increased cholesterol, both of which will be monitored in the clinic. The next medication is called Celcept or Myfortic. This medication is also twice a day and lifelong. Stomach side effects can occur with this medication, and taking it with food usually helps prevent these issues. This drug can also affect your white cell count and platelets, which will be monitored closely. The fourth medication is called prednisone. This is a common drug used for a wide range of conditions that you have already heard of. For transplant, it's being used to prevent rejection. It'll be taken once a day, and whether it is lifelong or not varies depending on your risk for rejection. Most patients will continue a low dose for life. Only patients at a very low risk of rejection may stop this drug early. Prednisone will be taken as a taper schedule, which means that we're going to be going from a higher dose to a lower dose. By the time of the end of the first month after transplant, you'll be on a low dose, and depending on your risk for rejection, that low dose may be continued on or stopped. Prednisone does have a few side effects that need to be noted. Mainly, it can increase your blood sugar. This can sometimes require you to check your blood sugars and possibly take some insulin while you're on this medication, especially at the higher doses. This is usually short term, and if you have not previously been diabetic or have blood sugar issues, we may need you to monitor your blood glucose a little bit more closely. We'll be closely monitoring your blood glucose in the hospital, but if you need to go home on insulin or to check your blood glucose, we'll be teaching you how to do so. The fifth medication on this list is called Neulogics or Belatacept. This medication is sometimes used instead of Prograf, depending on your risk of rejection. Your rejection risk depends on the donor kidney that you will receive. This drug is an IV infusion. At the beginning, the infusions may be more frequent, but eventually you'll be on a monthly infusion, either at an infusion center nearby your house or by a home health nurse who will be coming to your home. This medication is lifelong and is very well tolerated. The most common side effects are listed on the slide. Now let's talk about a few key points before we continue on to the next slide. There are many drug interactions with Prograf, so it's important that you reach out to the clinic if you are going to start a new medication, or even if another provider wants you to start a new medication. To protect your kidneys, you will need to avoid NSAIDs or other painkillers that may hurt your kidney, such as ibuprofen, naproxen, especially after transplant. Acetaminophen or Tylenol is a safe over-the-counter medication that you can take after transplant. Prograf also has interactions with grapefruit and pomegranate. You cannot eat or drink these fruits after the transplant. For women of childbearing ages, we have to use caution with Celcept or Myfortic to avoid pregnancy, as this medication can cause birth defects. There are specific forms of contraception that we'll talk about in more detail after the transplant. If you do plan on having children in the future, there are options to switch that would be possible. In case of switching medications, we would need to do that at least 6 weeks before trying to get pregnant. These next group of medications are the anti-infectives, which help to prevent infections. You'll be on two of the following medications. The first medication is called Bactrim. This is an antibiotic and is typically taken to prevent different bacterial infections, including a certain type of pneumonia. This drug will be once a day for 6 months. This medication can make you more sensitive to the sun and can possibly cause a rash. If a rash does occur, or if you already have a Bactrim or a sulfa allergy, then we'll use another medication in place of this medication. We recommend use of sunscreen with an SPF or sun protection factor 30 or higher. The next drug is called Valcyte. This helps prevent viral infections, specifically one called CMV or cytomegalovirus. It also protects against herpes viruses like chickenpox, shingles, and cold sores. It'll be once a day and be taken for 3 or 6 months. We will monitor your white blood cells and we recommend taking with food to prevent stomach upset. The third medication on this list is called Valtrex, which sometimes replaces the Valcyte. This drug also helps prevent other herpes viral infections like chickenpox, shingles, and cold sores, but does not prevent CMV. If you are at a low risk of developing CMV, then you'll receive this medication. Valtrex is usually well tolerated and the most common side effects are listed on the side. Next up is other post-transplant medications. Some of your current medications will be continued and others will be stopped after transplant. After transplant, the medications you're currently taking for your kidney disease will be stopped. These may include phosphate binders, fluid electrolyte medications such as water pills, multivitamins, and anemia medications like iron or Aranesp. Some other drugs that you are taking may be continued. These could include blood pressure, thyroid, antidepressant, and cholesterol medications. Please have a family member or friend available to bring these medications if they are to be continued. All of your new post-transplant medications are typically arranged through a transplant specialty pharmacy that takes your insurance. However, some insurances may require you to use mail order pharmacy. Please be prepared that the insurance mail order pharmacy may require you to set up an account and arrange the delivery of medications to the hospital. As previously mentioned, there are many drug interactions with our medications. We will give a comprehensive list of medications that you are to take. You will want to clear any over-the-counter, herbal, and prescription medications that are not on the list given to you by the transplant team before taking them. We will also be reviewing your vaccine history and your lab work to determine if there are any vaccines you need prior to transplant. One special note is that you can no longer receive any live vaccines the 4 weeks prior to your transplant or at any time after you receive the transplant. Live vaccines contain live virus and could potentially make you ill if you were on immune-lowering medications. Some examples of live vaccines include measles, mumps, and rubella, varicella, or chickenpox. There are some also older vaccines of the shingle shot called Zostavax that you cannot take. If you ever aren't sure if a vaccine is live, please check with the transplant center before getting it. The vaccines that we'll keep you up to date on are the killed vaccines. These include the flu shot, two different types of pneumonia shots, tetanus shot, and hepatitis A and B shots. You will be informed of the vaccines that you need by the transplant team, and those can usually be given in the clinic. This is an example of the medication schedule that a transplant pharmacist will create for you after transplant and use when teaching you the medications. On the left-hand side, it has all of your medications listed out with both the brand and generic name, the strength of the drug, and a picture. The middle of the schedule has the time of the day you'll be taking your drugs and how many of each one. We'll provide you with a pill box that has times on it that will match up with the times on your schedule, which makes the process of filling your pill box very organized. Lastly, the right side of the list tells you what the drug is used for and any additional information we want you to know. The transplant pharmacist will play a key role in educating you on your medications and answering any questions that you have. They'll create the medication schedule and go over it with you several times when you're in the hospital. They'll ensure that you're comfortable with your medications by discharge and are available after discharge for any follow-up education, questions, or concerns. The transplant pharmacist also plays a large role in assisting in obtaining all of your medications, so they are delivered to your room at the hospital before discharge. You will get practice filling your medication box with your caregiver and pharmacist assisting you before you go home from the hospital. This information can be overwhelming, so please keep in mind that the pharmacist will go over all this information again with you after the transplant, and you'll have many opportunities to discuss any questions that you have at that time. Thank you for your time in watching this video. We look forward to seeing you and serving you.